The Falling Walls, Science Breakthrough of the Year 2022 in Physical Sciences. Breaking the wall to precision measurement. How interfering rainbows of light waves change optical sensing. Nathalie Piquet, Max Planck Institute of Quantum Optics.
On November 9th, 1989, as a teenager living near Paris, France, I was preparing for my high school final exams.
Good afternoon. Most of what we know about our world, we know it through light. Every day, when there is an object that we would like to watch in detail, we just shine light on the object, just like I am doing with this flash lamp. In our experiments of optics, that's pretty much the same. We use our laser light in order to provide the most precise tools to study the structure of matter. In experimental physics, looking for ever higher precision is a good strategy. In basic research, if one is more precise than ever before, well, perhaps one will be lucky and one will discover some phenomenon which was previously unknown. On a more applied touch, it can enable to tackle some of the most pressing challenges of our society. Let me give an example. This example is dealing with climate change. We all know that we must significantly reduce the emissions of greenhouse gases and of pollutants in our atmosphere. But in order to reduce this, we need to monitor. And so ideally, we would like to have small sensors able to track many gases simultaneously that we could very massively deploy at factories, in farms, in our cities. These sensors would enable to verify that the levels are indeed decreasing. They would enable to test new solutions. In order to if these sensors could be deployed locally, they would also provide some interesting data for atmospheric scientists. It would complement the very global vision that they have using satellites, and it would complement, enable to perfect the models and to increase the to make better predictions. And of course, as the levels of emission will get lower, the sensors will have to become more and more precise. So from the instrumentation point of view, that's quite challenging. One wants sensors which are rapid, sensitive, able to monitor simultaneously, very precisely, many gases, tens of gases. And if one wants to deploy them massively, they have to be cheap, easy to use, very robust. So to this type of challenge, experimental physics, and in particular optical spectroscopy, can provide some solution. With optical spectroscopy, light interrogates a gas, and we look how the colors of the light are modified by the interaction with the gas. Certain colors will be strongly attenuated by the interaction with the gas. And this can enable us to tell unambiguously what are the molecules which are the compounds inside the gas, and one can even determine what is the concentration of each of these molecules. So this is something which is very well known and which has existed for more than a century. And in order to achieve this goal very precisely, there is a technique which is called interferometry, which is very efficient. Interferometry consists in overlapping light waves, and with this overlap, in certain conditions, the light waves can either reinforce each other or cancel each other. Looking how these light waves interact, can tell us some information about the gas which have interacted with the light. So that's devices which are known, which are commercially available, and which are called Fourier transform spectrometers. So that's instruments which are very powerful, which are able to simultaneously measure and identify tens of gases in a single measurement. But as you can see on this picture, that's instruments which are complex, which are expensive, several hundred thousands of euros. And in their principle, in order to be able to distinguish the very subtle signature of the different gases, in order to have a high resolution, one needs to make a measurement with a moving mirror, which is displaced over several meters. So it is not compatible with the objective of having very compact and very cheap sensors. So our breakthrough has been to develop a technique which enables to measure interference without moving parts. So we no longer have optical aberrations, we no longer have any limitation due to geometry. So how does it work? It doesn't work, yeah. It's very slow, I think. Yeah. We use laser tools which are called frequency comb lasers. So what is a frequency comb laser? Well, that's a laser which emits extremely short pulses. Extremely short means a few femtoseconds, a femtoseconde being a millionth of a billionth of a second. And if one looks at the spectrum of one such short, ultra-short pulse, the spectrum is very broad. That's typically all the colors of the rainbow. But these lasers do not emit a single pulse. They emit a train of pulses with a repetition frequency of emission of the pulses, which is very precise and very periodic. Not only this pulses are periodic, but the waveform inside the pulses is very periodic. And as a consequence, the spectrum is made of narrow laser lines, which are evenly spaced. That's a very remarkable property. Laser frequency combs have been developed at the end of the 90s for the objective of frequency metrology, and they have become key to better timekeeping, for instance, by making it possible to develop optical clocks. The way we use these frequency combs is different. We use two such frequency combs. We use two such frequency combs that we combine in an interferometer. Our two lasers have slightly different pulse repetition frequency. As we like to do spectroscopy, to interrogate some gas, the beam of one of the combs interact with a gas which is here contained in a gas cell. We then combine the two beams on a beam splitter, and we measure their interference signal, their interaction, as a function of time on a fast photodetector. What is remarkable about this tool is that there are no moving parts, but only a measurement as a function of time. Let me try to explain a little bit more how it works. In the time domain, we have a periodic train of pulses which is emitted by our laser. So that's these waveforms which are here. Through the interaction with the gas sample, the molecule vibrates and rotates, and this creates a tail of the signal which is here. This signal oscillates extremely quickly. We do not know how to directly measure it. So the trick that we use the second laser, which is asynchronous compared to the first laser, in order to sample our signal. In this way, the waveform which was oscillating very fast appears stretched in time, and because this is interferometry, it is stretched in a very faithful manner. So we stretch our waveform so that we can make our measurement using standard electronics, standard photodetectors. In doing so, we can then measure spectra, which are extremely resolved. And this is an example of the type of experimental data that we obtain. So that's a spectrum of a laboratory spectrum of the ethylene molecule. And what we look at is how the molecule vibrates as a function of energy. So our spectrum looks all black. That's the comb lines, which are resolved. And now in this small animation, we can see the details in the spectrum. And one can start to see some dips. And these dips are the signature of the molecule. So that's the information we are looking for. And what is remarkable about this spectrum is that the absolute frequency of any of these comb lines is known within the accuracy of an atomic clock. So we provide a tremendous improvement in the accuracy of optical spectroscopy. That's not only this. We can observe the transition of our molecules, which are about the same spectrum, which is rendered a little bit differently. And all these transitions are the signature of our molecule. These signatures, one can see in this zoom in, that's a spectrum which is very crowded, which is made of tiny little details, and measuring these details enables to very precisely measure the concentration of the molecule in our sample. But this was obtained using a laboratory instrument, which is a state-of-the-art spectroscopy, but which is compact, but still rather big, and does not fulfill the idea of having very compact sensors. For this type of laboratory spectroscopy, what we bring is a much higher resolution than ever before, which means that we can think about making very precise contributions to fundamental physics, such as a better determination of fundamental constants. But when we are very resolved and very precise in the laboratory, with our time domain technique, it also means that we can be extremely compact. And so we can develop instruments which are very, very small. And on this picture, you see four of our lasers. So a laser that's an optical cavity together with a gain medium. And here, one of the optical cavities starts here, continues here. And then we have a waveguide which is wrapped in a spiral. So that a cavity which normally, once it is deployed, is several centimeters long, here it fits in a footprint of less than 1 square millimeter. And to give a better idea of how compact is the device that we are developing, this is a little chip compared to a match. So with this type of improvement into the compactness of our device, we can dream about having our spectrometers on tiny little chips that would fit, for instance, on a mobile phone. And so this is a little animation which summarizes our vision for the next development. We are dreaming about developing our tiny little spectrometers at the scale of a wafer. So we would have many of these tiny spectrometers that would, each of the spectrometers would be very small compared to the size of a mobile phone. And this would provide gas sensors able to measure simultaneously the transitions from tens of gases on a tiny little chip. So this example of what we can do with our new type of interferometry is only one example. I think it's very relevant to climate change, but gas sensing is also relevant to many other topics. One can think, for instance, of industrial process control. We can dream about interrogating also samples in the condensed phase, like chemical reactions or samples of biological relevance. Our development is not limited to spectroscopy. Interferometry is a technique which is very which is used in many other areas of science and technology. We can also make very precise distance measurements. Precise distance measurements find also some applications, for instance, in cars when one tries to park a car. There is a sensor. One can also do holography and make three-dimensional imaging of for instance biological samples. And so with this, I hope that I have convinced you that our application finds many possible applications. And I just want to conclude by saying that it's a type of research which was curiosity-driven, which started about 15 years ago. At that time, we had no idea that there would be any applications. And now we are amazed of the number of applications that we find for our type of interferometry. Thank you very much.